Hello, welcome back to Really Good The Peers, where we chat about and discuss all sorts of movies. My name is Gary O'Brien, and joining me as always for the monthly recaps, it's David Scanlon, as we talk about the film releases of August 2024. So stick around, we hope you enjoy. David, you're back. Hello, how are you? Well,
not too bad.
What's the crack? What's the story of Morning Glory?
Yeah, we should try and see how many we can fit into the...
Okay, here's a little fun thing for the episode. I'm going to try and fit in as many Oasis. And because I'm a diehard Oasis fan, I know all their songs. It'll be so easy for me. I'm not going to put the Wikipedia discography. Have it here, David. I'm such a fan. Yeah, so what's the crack, David? This is your 42nd episode. It's the meaning of life, David.
42nd.
You'll figure out what the meaning of life is now that you've done the 42nd episode.
This is also our anniversary.
It is our anniversary, yeah. We've known each other 15 years. For as long as we've known each other, Oasis haven't been together, and now they're back together. So now we're parting ways.
This is our breakup show.
Yeah. Look, some things like this can't live forever, David. But I'm not going to... All I'll ask is don't look back.
Jesus Christ.
David, don't stand by me. Go let it out.
Don't go away, Gary.
The Hindu times. Anyway. So...
That's going to get old quick.
Hey, Lord, don't slow me down. Okay. Yes, for anyone who doesn't know, this is where me and David scream into the microphones. We talk about the movies we saw in the previous month. This month is August. Some great movies this month, David. Do you know what? There's two movies in this that are actually my top three movies of the year so far.
And whoa!
No, they're not Trap. It's not Trap, and it's not The Instigator, so you can play a fun game which of the other three they are.
Okay.
Cool.
I figured it out.
There you go. Good man. There's time codes if people want to jump around. If you want to leave a comment on the YouTube, the Spotify, do so. Let us know what you've watched.
Did you get any this week?
I have some people for the table saw the other days.
I look forward to it.
I meant to do something else, actually. I'll see if I can do it during the podcast. I was going to invent a sort of a peer review thing where I know I had it before where I'll just combine everyone who follows me and I follow them on Letterboxd. I'll combine all the scores together and then we'll have a Reeling the Peers average. Yeah.
Oh, nice.
I feel like that could work.
Letterboxd average.
Yeah, Letterboxd average. And then I forced everyone to get Letterboxd. I was out last night and I forced someone to get Letterboxd.
Good. Yeah.
It's working. I don't get paid by them, but I should. If anyone doesn't know what Letterboxd is, it's basically a website where you can log all the movies you watch and put up reviews and ratings if you want.
It's the best social media.
It's the best. It's the only one I care about. Someone would be putting up a copy they had on Instagram, boo, let me know if you watched Apocalypse Now. You know?
Yeah.
It's not like I...
Did you watch Superman 3?
Someone could be out having a lovely dinner in Grano and Stony Batter, and I won't care, but if they've watched Das Boot... I'm all here for it, buddy.
How would you rank Martin Sheen's best movies?
Yeah, I that's not going to be on your Instagram, but it'll be on your Letterboxd.
Yeah.
So get Letterboxd. I'll put a link to join Letterboxd. Yeah. I tell you what, the first five people who join it will get a thumbs up. I'm splashing the cash.
Could you not send them out, do you not have Reeling the Peers merch? You got Reeling the Peers merch.
I do, yeah. I have a deck of cards that I got as a gift, and I've been using them the last couple of weekends. Everyone's like, oh, did you make those? I'm like, no, they're a gift. I'm not that sad. But I do have a pop socket I made myself.
Yeah. That's useful, though.
It is. It's multi-purpose. Anyway, it's advertising, and it's also functional.
We're 5 minutes deep, and
we
haven't even mentioned the movie.
Okay, we're talking about Blink. Twice. We're talking about Trap. Talking about Kneecap, The Instigators, and Alien Romulus. And we're also talking about what's coming out next month.
Cool.
David, you want to hit us up with Blink Twice?
So, Blink Twice is the directorial debut. Feature-length directorial debut by Zoe Kravitz. Yeah. It is a story about two women, Frida and Jess, who are very good friends. They live together. They're kind of, I wouldn't say down on their luck, but they're just the average individual who are just striving, for more out of life. And they are working at a party that is hosted by Slater King, played by Channing Tatum, who is this kind of tech mogul CEO billionaire in the form of almost like an Elon Musk type.
Mm-hmm.
And at the party, when they finish their shift, they decide to hop into some cocktail, get involved with the inner circle of Slater King, and he invites them back to his private island with him and a load of his friends and a load of their partners, we assume. But the island isn't exactly what it seems.
It's because he's been cancelled.
We know he's been cancelled for vague reasons. Mm-hmm. And that's as far as I want to go, because that's all you really need to know. But you're very aware very early on that there's something going on behind the scenes.
Don't watch the trailer.
Yeah.
I hadn't watched the trailer. Watch the trailer after I watched this.
Yeah.
And I loved watching the movie knowing nothing about it.
Yeah.
That description is perfect. That's all you need.
Yeah.
And I... It's... It, it's a rich billionaire inviting women to his private island with, and they, he takes their phones off them.
Yeah.
Shit's gonna go wrong.
Something's off.
And there's an eerie tone without, throughout. So you're gonna pick up on that fairly quickly.
Yeah.
What a movie, eh?
Great vibes.
What?
Great vibe. No, like honestly, just the director. Direction of, sorry, the movie just making process.
Women to private island. What a
story,
vibe, man.
The story is terrible. But yeah. I just first to just go on the point of Zoe Kravitz's directorial debut. Beautiful looking film.
Yep.
The colors really pop. This is all kind of shot on location in this tropical island kind of type setting. Stacked cast.
Yeah.
Like a lot of faces, you'll be like, hey, you'll be like Leo in Once Upon a Time. Hey, I know that guy.
Christian Slater, Simon Rex, yeah. Adria Arjona, Haley Joel Osment, Gina Davis,
yeah,
Kyle MacLachlan, and Zoe Kravitz herself. Is he? Yeah, she plays swanky stewardess.
Oh, cool. She's on the plane.
Yeah.
And then what I would say is very important story as well. And there's a few twists and turns, and it keeps you on the edge of your seat. There's a, as you say, as you mentioned, a very eerie tone, but important.
Yeah, it starts eerie, becomes tense, and then is...
I would say it has the same kind of vibes as something like a Midsommar, like maybe not as far as Midsommar, but you know the way Midsommar had that thing of like, it's always bright, and this should feel normal?
Yeah, because they're partying every night. Yeah. Every time they put a champagne glass down, it's being refilled. Yeah. They're eating fancy gourmet food. Like, everything is great. They're being asked all the time, you're having a good time. They say they're having a great time.
Yeah.
You know, it's paradise.
Yeah.
But there's a sense of unease. Yeah. And without going into it, like you say, there is a very uncomfortable development that a lot of people might find hard to watch and sit through.
Yeah, I don't know. Did you see that on
there's a trigger warning? Yeah. But like you say, okay. So how I kind of describe it is, it's as much as I love her direction in it, it is very much a hodgepodge of the best things of a load of different types of movies. So it's got the same eerie, like, get the fuck out of there as Get Out. It has some of the same similar messaging as something like a Don't Worry, Darling. It's got that whole elitist rich vibe of The Menu. You've also got some other elements that develop in the plot that are similar to Promising Young Woman.
Yeah.
There's also, I noticed some of these myself, but I saw a lot of them from reviews, so I've kind of added all the best ones together. There's another one here that was a bit rogue that I thought you would appreciate because you've watched the movie, but a similar vibe to a movie called Men as well.
Yeah.
Don't watch Men. It's awful. And then also similar to The White Lotus as well.
Yeah.
So it's kind of taken all these themes, unsettling thrillers, all these like unsettling thrillers about like race, gender, and sort of wealth.
Yeah.
And combine them all together into one story, which at times I felt was a bit unfocused, but there's a, like you say, there is a turning point in the movie where it switches laser focus onto one particular theme.
So my biggest criticism of the film is that the whole concept of them just going through the same thing over day after day, and it gets to the point that they don't even remember what day it is. That just goes on for slightly too long.
Yeah,
and I feel like if they cut to as you say, that kind of trigger or that kind of focused piece a little bit earlier, it would have been, I think it would have been better. But I can understand that they want to kind of maybe over exaggerate that idea of just like they're just doing the same thing over again, no matter what happens. You know, they, as you say, they fill their champagne glasses, they get all this great food, they have these lovely drugs,
they're having a fat blunt.
Yeah
That's part of the movie. I'm not just really excited about blunts. Although no.
And then the other thing I really enjoyed is that there is danger, but you don't know where it's coming from.
Yes, exactly.
There's so much happening, and you like, don't know with what it's...
Everything is paradise.
Yeah.
Now, what I will say is, for some reason, there's just a load of fucking snakes hissing about the garden, and there's some like woman who works there who's like killing them.
Yeah.
That's just, it's a bit, that's a bit Midsommar-y kind of vibes.
Yeah.
But that's the only thing of like, what the fuck's she up to? What the fuck's she up to?
Yeah.
I don't know if you know this, but did you know what the original title of the movie was?
Yeah, Pussy Island.
Pussy Island. Apparently she fought so hard to try and get it. They wouldn't give it to her.
Yeah. Didn't really test well.
I can imagine so. Yeah. But Blink Twice has a... They really, whatchacallit, saved it. The sound as well is the other thing I want to mention. Yeah. So tense. Just the scoring, sound design.
There's certain things, like Channing Tatum has a vape that has a very specific sound, and is a very important lighter throughout the movie. And again, anytime someone lights something, it's just, it's over-exaggerated the sound of it that just makes a noise and stuff.
Yeah. I, like, dying to see what she does next.
Yeah.
Also, Naomi Aki.
Yeah, brilliant.
She's great. She's in the series End of the Fucking World.
Yeah.
She's also in a really bad Star Wars movie, but I'm going to forget about that.
Which one is she?
She's What's her name? I don't know the name. She's
Last
in the,
Jedi?
She's the last... No, she's in the Rise of Skywalker.
She's in Mickey 17.
Yes, and she's also in a TV show called Industry that's meant to be quite good.
Oh, actually, that was the other thing I wanted to say about the movie. So Channing Tatum's character is Slater King, so everyone just calls him Slater. But Christian Slater's also in this movie, and I kept getting confused.
All right. Why did they call him by his real name?
Yeah.
Simon Rex. Also want to give him a bit of a shout out as well. He's in a fantastic movie called Red Rocket. People should go watch. It's also a bit uncomfortable, but it's very good. Haley Joel Osment, sure. Gina Davis.
She's good, yeah.
Why is she not in everything?
I know,
she's great. She's great in this. She's great in David. She's great in Stuart Little. But also other good movies. She's in Beetlejuice, the original Beetlejuice. Yeah. But, yeah.
Adria Arjona. Yeah. She was brilliant. Yeah. And then
she saved her 2024 for me.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, sir, of
she's
course.
A hitman. More like shit, man. David, I burned it so bad.
But it is, by the end, it's just girls being mates.
Yeah, girl power.
Yeah.
There's a Beyonce needle drop that really works.
Yeah, works.
But look, won't say anything more about it.
Just go watch it.
Go watch it. It's
even if you're not into like, it would be a thriller more than anything?
It's an unsettling thriller. Yeah. So I wouldn't say like, I'd be cautious about when to go see it, but like, just make sure you're in a good vibe.
Yeah.
Going it. Not like happy, but more like if things are stressful and you're...
Yeah.
Yeah, just don't go in. It's not going to help.
This is not an easy watch.
Yeah.
But it's great.
It's really good. First time director, great cast, visuals, sound, the whole shebang.
Yeah.
Right, should we move on to a bad movie?
Okay.
Called Trap. More like crap. I'm burning them all today, David. So this is about a father and a teen daughter attend a pop concert where they realize they're at the center of a dark, sinister event. So what happens is there is a concert for this artist called Lady Raven. Ooh. And Josh Hartnett plays Cooper Adams and brings his daughter Riley to this concert. And they go to the concert, they're having a good time, but they notice there's a really like beefed up security. There's a load of police. There's an FBI. He's wondering what's going on. And he makes friends with a t-shirt salesman and he discovers that this entire concert is a way to trap this serial killer called the Butcher. They've discovered that he's attending the concert and there is a serious effort to try and hunt him down. They have a profiler there who's trying to pick out who it could be, and it's a really cool thriller to see the point of view of the serial killer, Josh Hartnett, you know it's him, trying to get out. So it's a bit like, you know, like Dexter Morgan.
Yeah.
You're really rooting for him to get out. And it's a bit like a video game in the sense you're just like, oh, he's trying this exit, but this is covered by this. He needs this pass. And it's really, really interesting. And then it just takes a fucking nosedive after like, they get out of the concert. Spoiler. It's not even that much of a spoiler. Because there's another hour after that. That is so balls. It's unnecessary. And it just loses all of the drama and the tension that the movie had built up. It also doesn't help that it's directed by M. Night Shyamalan, who unfortunately wrote it, which means that it sounds like two AI chatbots trying to talk to each other.
Yeah.
The dialogue is so wooden and so stiff. And it's weird to see Josh Hartnett go from something like Oppenheimer, where I thought he was unbelievable, into this, because it makes sense for his character to be really like robotic and faking human emotions.
Yeah.
But there's other characters in it. Like, he's talking to the t-shirt salesman and he sounds like he's from a video game, like just completely full of exposition. And then there's another mom from like Riley's friend's mom's there, and she's just doesn't seem like a real person either. It's just full of weird human interactions. But the movie's good for the thriller aspect of him trying to get out of the concert.
Yeah.
And then he gets out of the concert and then it takes a nosedive.
So hold on, this movie is Just over 45.
Yeah.
So you're saying for the first 45 minutes, good, and then there's
an hour? The first 45, 50 minutes, it's not good. It's just like, you're wondering how he gets out, and he's doing all these different things, and it's cool. Like, it's definitely has some similarities to like a Taylor Swift thing, where like, it's all these fans who know all the dance moves, and there's someone who goes up on stage, and there's all these like things. Anyway, they get out, and fuck me, dude. A fun fact, but the Lady Raven, the pop star, it's played by M. Night Shyamalan's daughter. And let's just say her character has a big focus in the second act.
Okay, yeah, I was going to say that.
Yeah, and just like, why? There's a really cool thing about it where they have this FBI profiler in it who's like psychoanalyzing what he might do next. And it's really cool to see them pitted against each other, as in like, he grabs a walkie and he's able to hear what she's thinking. And he goes, things like, she's like, oh, he's going to cause a distraction next because he knows we're onto him. So like, watch out for any fire alarms being put. And he was going to pull a fire alarm.
Yeah.
So it's cool stuff like that. And then she disappears for the second half of the movie because we focus on the singer. It's just, it's a bit disappointing, but what do you expect from M. Night Shyamalan?
So would you say it would be better if it was written by someone else, or would you say it would be better if it was directed by someone else?
Written by someone else, because it sounds like it's written by a chatbot.
Yeah.
But he self-finances his own movies, so like no one's gonna stop him.
And then the best way I can kind of get my head around this is we've seen a couple of M. Night Shyamalan movies in recent years. So Split was great.
Yes.
So this is obviously worse than Split.
Yeah.
The last few we've had Glass.
I haven't seen Glass.
Oh, you haven't seen Glass? No. No. Skip it. We've seen Knock at the Cabin.
Oh, fuck yeah.
And then we've seen Old.
Yeah.
So better or worse than those movies?
This movie had, okay, put it this way. This movie, so Knock at the Cabin, if you recall, I think we were really excited about the tension and then never went anywhere.
Yeah.
So that was a bit disappointing. Old was just laughably bad.
Yeah.
This is better than Old because that's a really, it's not even a strong 45 minutes, just really interesting and it's fun.
Yeah.
But it doesn't
go anywhere.
It does, but where it goes is just,
you're just not happy.
No.
Okay. So
I'm just not happy with life, David. This movie didn't solve it.
Interesting. Okay. Yeah.
I wouldn't say rush out to watch it, but it's a fun, do you know what? Watch the first four, watch it on stream and then turn it off once he gets out of the concert. Because okay. it's not gonna bring you any joy.
Okay, fair. Yeah.
There's a cool element of like how they knew he was at the concert.
Yeah.
Okay. It's so shit. That's not yeah.
I think conceptually, I think you're right. It is an interesting concept, but I can see where you're coming from that it just takes a turn.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, I feel like M. Night's like, he just, when he gets an idea.
It's not even a twist.
I don't think it's a twist. I think it's just, he gets an idea and he's like, oh, I'm just going to keep following this.
Yeah. It's like he wrote his script literally rather than, Anyway, that's all I want to talk about that.
Yeah, that's right, enough.
We'd move on to kneecap, more like knee great. It was more anti-burn, David.
So kneecap is the story of the...
Well, first of all, there is a full episode on this that came out last week.
Yeah, we'll run through
we'll
this.
But I'm keen to hear your thoughts because we haven't spoken about it.
Yeah, so kneecap is the story of the rap group from Belfast called Kneecap, who are made up of Nisha, Limog and JJ.
Who formed the band Kneecap, which is the movie Kneecap.
This is a partially fictionalized version of their life, of how they came together and formed the band.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I suppose that's it really, isn't it?
Yeah, I get it.
The best way I describe it is this is the vibe of 8 Mile crossed with Trainspotting.
Yeah.
It has the kind of erratic nature of a Trainspotting, but also it's about rap and stuff. So, or even like NWA or something like that. Or sorry, not NWA, Straight Outta Compton. Hilariously funny. Mm-hmm. Very well directed. Like, mm-hmm. Again, chaotic direction, but like very easy to enjoy and
great
stuff.
Great vibes.
Great vibes, yeah. I've seen that. I've watched that scene a couple of times now. It seems to come up just in clips of them talking to the therapists.
Yeah,
looking for the
health.
Drugs.
Yeah.
Which is just, it's cut together so perfectly. And again, I know it's like literally just one of them talking, the other one talking. And it's just, they just line up so perfectly. But then again, I just need to mention the acting is incredible. Like, considering these are just like rappers and they had no acting experience, just for them to kind of hop in, I feel like they paired them up quite well with their storylines and stuff. And then personally, like, I really enjoyed the music. Again, I would have known a couple of their songs. They have a song with Green Chatton from Fontaines, which I would have known beforehand, but then the rest of them I kind of had, I looked up a couple of their songs and stuff, and they're good and stuff. Yeah, it's just great to see the idea of like the Irish language kind of broadening itself beyond just like traditional storylines and stuff. Like, I know Colin Keown was great, but I've always seen that type of story with the Irish language, where now it's good to see it in more kind of modern setting and stuff, and being used kind of in a modern, or kind of modern ideas of just like spreading the Irish language and stuff like that. But yeah, no, great. I don't have a huge amount more to say. Love to see again what the director and stuff do after this. Great to see Michael Fassbender getting on board and producing. He's been kind of hit and miss over the last while, so it's great to see him now in a role where he's again promoting a good kind of independent movie and stuff like that. So yeah, not much more else to say.
Cool. And I have 40 minutes of a conversation with Circa that last week, the people who listen to.
Would you do Kenneman to write a rap album?
No. To do a podcast, also no.
Exactly. This would be a totally different vibe.
Yeah. Would it be easier to edit? Be easier to understand.
Some of the cuts as well, when they're higher stones, is very funny.
You mean like when they cut the drugs?
Yeah.
Nice. Yeah. Right. Should we move on to the segment we called Tell You What I Saw the Other Day?
Yeah, sounds good.
Right. Do you want to start us off? Will I start us off?
I don't have anything.
You don't have anything? Cool. I have a straight run. You've seen some of these. Okay. You've actually seen one. You've seen two.
Is these ones you've seen, or these ones that our listeners
have
seen?
I have two. I've seen three. Have been sent in.
Okay, great.
We've got Contagion. on Amazon Prime, directed by Steven Soderbergh.
Oh, it's on Prime?
Yeah.
I'll add it to the list.
Just seriously do. It's a lot of fun is the wrong word. It's okay, so basically it's just about a global pandemic and Gwyneth Paltrow's character.
Does this have a trigger warning?
No. It's far enough away from COVID, I think, that it's not as traumatizing.
3 years. No, wait, 2 years. No, what would it be? 2 years BC?
2 years BC.
No, AC.
AC. After COVID. So, yeah, it's basically about a global pandemic. Gwyneth Paltrow's character gets this virus and then it kind of starts off a chain reaction. But what's cool about it is it's similar to a lot of other Soderbergh movies where he's just like, I want, like, 9 storylines happening at once. So you have like Matt Damon's like the husband of Gwyneth Paltrow's character and how he deals with it and kind of continuing on through the pandemic. You have the people trying to cure it. You have the people in the government trying to handle the sort of PR side of things. You have the scientists working on it. Did I say that? I can't remember. So scientists, government, you also have like military people, how they're dealing with it. You have
stuff,
you have like other countries, you know, and then you also have, what's really interesting is you have a Jude Law character who's spreading lies about the vaccine and saying like, you don't trust the vaccine, have this thing called fluoroxide.
That's really ahead of its time.
Exactly. Yeah. And it's all like, no, trust me, this is the cure. And then he was benefiting from it and stuff.
Yeah.
So it's really like, it gets a lot on it, David, as you might have seen my review. The only thing it didn't get right is that they didn't include the €9 substantial meal. You have to have a pint at a pub. But other than that, it's really like a lot of it's at like OR numbers, like OR factors, social distancing, like all this stuff was in the movie.
Yeah.
But it's really interesting. There's a really strong pacing to it because it's moving, because it's as the movie ramps up, so does the virus kind of thing. Yeah. So it's a thrilling watch. I watched it on train and it was great. I just didn't want to touch any surface after it. But my only issue with it is how it resolves itself is quite anticlimactic. Similar how there was no big end to COVID. It just kind of
petered out.
Yeah. Same with the movie.
Yeah.
But no, on Prime, I think it's an hour and 40, maybe hour 45. Yeah. Definitely worth a watch.
Okay, interesting. Yeah, because I'm a big fan of Steven Soderbergh. Like he's one of those directors that just seems to be so adaptable.
Mm-hmm.
Like, You're telling me he's made Contagion. He's also made Logan Lucky. Like,
and he also made Magic Mike.
Yeah, exactly. Like, it's incredible.
And also similar to most of his other movies, an unbelievably stacked cast. Yeah. Matt Damon, Kate Winslet, Jude Law, Lawrence Fishburne, Gwyneth Paltrow, Marion Cotillard, Bryan Cranston, the list goes on. Mm. So yeah, I'd recommend it for
Seems like a very sound bloke as well, from what I've heard.
Soderbergh.
Yeah.
There you go.
I can't remember what movie it was. He fought to get it released or something like that. I can't remember. It was a big movie anyway.
Oh, there you go. Avatar 2, The Way of Water.
No, I don't think it was that. I think it was a smaller movie than that.
David, I'll bring up another one that you've seen, which is the movie Aliens.
What?
You've not seen Aliens?
I have seen Aliens, but who saw Aliens?
John.
Oh, John watched it for the first time?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Mm-hmm. Aliens is class. See, I'm going to talk more about this later on, but Aliens is incredible because there's that famous story of James Cameron going into the Fox studios and how he pitched it to them was he wrote the word alien and put an S at the end and then put a dollar sign through it. But no, Aliens is great. Like, the one of the best things I love about that movie is that the scene we first see kind of the military guys, that scene was shot last.
Mm-hmm.
So they've built up like the rapport with each other throughout like the shooting of this movie. And then what you get in that kind of like first scene for us chronologically, but like last scene for them is like this rapport and they've built up like a relationship and they're really getting on with each other and they've been through like the military training. So, and yeah, just incredible cast. Michael Biehn, Bill Paxton, RIP, obviously Ripley and stuff. Some incredible looking aliens.
Yeah.
Like they really took what was kind of the puppetry in the first one and they really pumped it up a level and yeah, some good CGI as well, but just I'll talk about more. I'll talk a bit more about it later on.
I think what the best thing that represent, that was nearly one of the worst things to happen to the Alien franchise because they were like, oh, it's an action movie.
Yeah.
And then they've all tried to make an action movie.
Exactly.
The first one was not an action movie. It was like a cat and mouse
horror movie. Yeah.
Like The Thing.
Yeah.
But yeah, John watched that, enjoyed it. I've one here, Fatal Attraction on Netflix.
Oh, nice.
Have you seen it?
No, it's me.
We'll watch it. This is not from me.
Although I watched
The person who suggested wanted me to refer to Michael Douglas as Shagger Michael Douglas because he's just shagging his way through the whole movie.
Has she seen
Basic Instinct? No, that's next.
That's next. I've seen that. I will say I watched Bridget Jones' Diary recently and it ruined the ending of that movie.
Oh, no way.
Yeah.
Oh, still watch it though.
Oh, well, I'll still watch
still
it.
Still watch it. It's very good though. Fatal Attraction's great. It's basically Michael Douglas has an affair with Glenn Close and he tries to break it off, but she then stalks him and his family and tries to...
Baby Reindeer.
Baby Reindeer. Exactly. But it's so good because you're kind of on her side. I am anyway. I'm like, fucking get him. He's a piece of shit. And then she starts doing some dodgy stuff. I'm like, I don't think I can back her anymore.
Like, I feel like Michael Douglas was typecast back in the
day. Yeah, 80s. He's just a man who fucks.
Yeah, exactly.
That's all
yeah.
he did. Between that basic instinct and I'm going to... Look, I don't think he has a sex scene on Wall Street, but you know he fucks.
The Game.
Oh, The Game, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah,
yeah, anyway. Michael Douglas, what a dude.
What a dude.
Hey, so there's that. There's also Triangle of Sadness on Netflix.
Who watched that?
Daniel, but not my cousin.
Just, okay.
Just one of the listeners.
Incredible, yeah. We've talked about this before, but the best scene in that is in the middle, in the boat, yeah. when shit hits the fan, literally.
Yeah, it's a movie that, it's kind of similar a bit to Elements of
yeah.
Twice. In
yeah.
that it's about these like uber rich people, yeah. the modeling industry, yeah. and... just how when shit hits the fan, how...
Who you can really back.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
trust.
It's a bit... It's all in Swedish?
Yeah,
no,
well...
Some of it's... No, it's not. What am I talking about? I mean, it's in English. Your man English, Harris yeah. Dickinson's in it.
Yeah.
It's a bit long. Really.
Woody Harrelson.
Woody Harrelson's in it. He's great. Yeah. I don't know. It's a bit of a... It's a bit of a weird one to watch, but I just wanted to throw it in here.
Yeah, like, no, it's great. I'd
love to see what
I
he
love
does
the
next.
Rich getting what's coming to them.
Eat the rich.
Eat the rich.
And the last one I have here is one I watched. It's called I gave this 5 stars, David.
Yeah.
It's called Final Cut, ladies and gentlemen. It's on YouTube and Vimeo. It's free to watch there. It's a very pretentious movie, but I love it. So what it is, I'd seen it. Okay, bit of backstory that no one cares about. David goes on phone.
No, sorry. I'm just looking up the next movie that I need to talk about.
So I'd seen this movie on Letterboxd, speaking of which, everyone is trying to the Letterboxd. First five people, they get a prize. And they... But all these actors were in it. And I assumed it was a documentary or something about like the history of Hollywood. But no, it's actually a movie directed by in 2012 by some Hungarian filmmaker whose name I forget, but also probably couldn't pronounce. It was submitted into Cannes. It actually closed the Cannes Film Festival. But what it is, it's a love story about a man finding a woman and falling in love. And they go through their ups and downs and such. But it's not... told with any original footage. They use footage from over 500 movies to stitch together
oh, wow.
different scenes of man getting up in the morning and then showering and then going for a walk. But it uses all these different clips like Saturday Night Fever and Midnight Cowboy. It uses scenes from The Mask. It uses scenes from Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, James Bond. Like all these movies I love. So not only are you watching a love story, but you're also just like basically doing the Leonardo DiCaprio get meme
yeah.
from What's My... Hey! So as Mr. Movies, as someone who's seen all the movies ever, David, I had a great time. I don't know if everyone would enjoy it, but there's a lot of movies, a lot of classic movies that I'd seen that I saw represented in this, and I had a great time. And it's just how they use different music cues. Oh, it was wonderful.
How did they get the rights to all this?
I don't really know, and I don't really care to ask. Yeah. I there's very limited information on it, or that I did very limited research on it.
Yeah.
I just watched it was an hour and 20 minutes. It drags a bit. Because you realize you're not, it's just, there's one bit in particular. It's just, but anyway, and then something happens at the end and all of a sudden saves it. And I had a great, I'm hesitant to recommend it.
Yeah.
But if you're a big pretentious movie lover like me,
yeah,
I think you'll really get a kick out of it. It's a lot of fun. It's very funny. I went to look at the Days of the Letterboxd list for it, of course, that lists all the movies. I've only seen 38% of the movies and I still had a good time. So my job is to watch all the rest of them and then watch it again and then I'll be happy.
How many hundreds of movies are in it?
There's 500 movies in it.
Wow.
There's 499 movies in it and one porno because they can't list the porno on Letterboxd because they don't do pornos on Letterboxd. But also there's movies.
Not yet.
Not yet. There's like Mad Men 24, those from House, I think, as well,
yeah.
is in it. Yeah, such a little gem. I had a really good time with it.
But so is this in like an official movie?
Yeah, it's on Letterboxd.
Okay.
But everyone's listed. Yeah, it has like Charlie Chapman. Ah, oh, man.
Interesting. Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
Look forward to
look, it. Look, give it until he meets her and they fall in love and they have dinner and then see how you feel.
Yeah, I was actually going to mention another movie, but I think we're fine. I was just going to mention my dad watched French Connection. I was talking to him about it.
Oh yeah, that's Disney Plus.
Yeah, he also watched a documentary about the filming of it.
Yeah,
and how William Friedkin hated Gene Hackman.
Yeah.
He thought he was a shit actor.
He won an Oscar for that.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and then there was a story again because it's the French Connection. He was looking for a French actor, and he had like a line of like 10 guys, and he pointed like the one he wanted, and then he turned up on set, and the guy that he thought he picked didn't turn up or whatever. There was a different guy. The guy that they brought on was actually Spanish. That caused chaos. I think that was just movie making in the 70s.
Do you know there was a sequel?
Yeah.
It's not very good.
Not very good.
No. Cool. Well, thanks to James Dad for that suggestion.
Yeah.
That's one to watch with your dad.
Yeah.
That's a dad movie.
That chase scene is incredible.
Oh, it's unbelievable.
Yeah.
Yeah. What was I watching? The Instigators wish it had a scene like that.
If anyone hasn't seen The French Connection and they like, if you like The Departed or something like that, just, get it.
Gritty detective. Yeah.
It's New York in the 70s. Oh my God, it's so dirty. It's so fucking dirty.
It's got wheelie bins now, it's fine.
Yeah, exactly.
Right, should we move on to the next one?
Yeah. Okay, The Instigators. This is a movie that was exclusively released on Apple TV Plus. Apple TV Plus, yeah.
Apple TV Plus.
And it stars Matt Damon and Casey Affleck as two down on their luck guys who decide that Rory and Cobby, yeah. Jesus, what names.
Cobby Murphy.
Who decide to, they need to get involved in a job that is being run by Michael Stuhlbarg and Jack Harlow for some reason.
So Michael Stuhlbarg plays Mr. Bisaghi.
Yeah.
And Jack Harlow plays Scalvo.
Who, like, Michael Stuhlbarg's character seems to be like a big kind of gangster in Boston. And so they decide that it's the weekend or week of the mayoral elections. And Ron Perlman's character has been elected year after year as the Boston mayor. So they decide, you know, every year, you know, every time he's elected, he gets all his donations. They're put into one safe. Cash only.
It's us.
And before they're wheeled off, you know, there's a chance that you can get into the safe and get at this cash. So they kind of, they prepare to do this heist. Unfortunately, he actually doesn't win the election and his opponent does. So when they do go in and try and steal the money, there's not really that much money there. So it kind of goes a little bit south. They go in and interact with Ron Perlman and his party and stuff and steal a load of stuff from them. But within that loot is some very important gear. Anyway, they have to go on the run across Boston and they're being chased down by a number of nefarious characters, including Ving Rhames. But what I'll say is it's silly, but it's grand. I always say when I start watching these types of streaming movies, I go in with a certain level of expectation that, you know,
low.
Yeah. And there's a few things they do and I thought Casey Affleck's character was pretty funny. I thought Matt Damon's probably a bit boring. Could have been
watching him in Contagion, exciting. He's better.
Yeah. There's one thing Casey Affleck does twice in the movie where I just had a great time with. It's so stupid as hell. But yeah, it's fine. I wouldn't say like you have to watch it or anything, but it's grand.
It's an hour and a half.
Yeah,
it's a harmless movie to have in the background. It's a good movie for, hey, I know that guy.
Yeah,
Doug Liman directs.
Yeah,
director.
Most of it doesn't make sense, but again, I thought it was a fun time.
See, I went in with the expectations. I went in with higher expectations than I should have.
Yeah,
but I think it's a very half baked script that's only good because of how the good chemistry between all the actors.
Yeah.
Hong Chau.
Yeah.
What the fuck are you doing in this? Get in better movies.
Looks
her and Gina Davis.
Yeah.
Better movie. I don't know. The action directing, it could be. I thought some of the editing was appalling. I couldn't follow some shit.
What do you mean you couldn't follow? Well,
it like, was just like.
There you
was,
couldn't follow the action.
It was just so much fast cuts. I was like, slow down. Like, a lot of it seemed practical.
Yeah.
Until it really wasn't. There was janky CGI that clearly
went to Duncan.
They actually went to Duncan, but I think they just took the CGI budget out to try and give Jason Sudeikis $9.5 billion to go come back as Ted Lasso.
Yeah, exactly.
But like you say, it's that cast, Matt Damon, Casey Affleck, Hong Chau, Paul Walter Hauser, Michael Stuhlbarg, Ving Rhames, Alfred Molina, Toby Jones.
Yeah, I will say, the whole thing with the two brothers, Michael Stuhlbarg and Alfred Molina, that just goes out the window. Like, it doesn't make sense, but it's fine.
Yeah.
I love the fact as well that Casey Affleck definitely needs help, but Hong Chau won't help him.
Playing his therapist.
Yeah, and they take her as a hot... It's so stupid.
If Netflix did it, you'd be... If Netflix made this and had Kevin Hart and...
No, but like, I think it's better than the average Netflix movie.
Okay.
Personally.
Okay. That's because it's set in Boston. You like the accents.
Yeah, it's Boston. It's funny, like... It is. You don't tell me you didn't enjoy it.
I enjoyed parts. I can't say I enjoyed
it. He's from Quincy. he lives down by the harbour.
They got to park the car at Harvard Yard.
Yeah.
Anyway, right. Should we talk about a really great movie?
Yeah. This is what I'm waiting for.
Yeah. We're talking about... Honestly. Everything else ignored.
No, but like, I mean,
I saved the best to last.
See, you gave me a little taster with Aliens earlier on.
Right, we're going to talk about now Alien Romulus, which is a movie directed by Fede Alvarez. It came out this month. Obviously, that's why we're talking about it. But it's set in the Alien universe, and I have the description here, which says, while scavenging the deep ends of a derelict space station, a group of young space colonizers come face to face with the most terrifying life form in the universe. So, for people who know their Alien movies, this is set soon after the first Alien movie, and there's these people working on this sort of mining planet. So you've got Rain, Andy, Tyler, Kay, Bjorn, and Navarro. They're all young adults, nearly, on this planet, but they want to get off it because there is this Weyland Corporation.
Weyland-Yutani.
Weyland-Yutani Corporation that is kind of keeping them there because it keeps bumping up the hours they have to serve to before they can be freed. But the nearest planet is 9 years away, so the only way to escape is to get some cryopods. But they've discovered that there's an abandoned space station above the planet that has these pods in, so they plan to just nip up there, grab the cryo chambers, and fucking go to sleep for 9 years, and then happy days. But it's an Alien movie, so everything that could go wrong goes possibly wrong. So there's a lot of twists and turns in this that I don't want to spoil, but obviously an alien shows up, and it's up to them to try and get these pods and get off the ship. But those pesky aliens, man.
They're always at it.
Always at it. This is a phenomenal movie. I loved it. It is a fantastic sci-fi thriller with great action set pieces, but also fantastic production design from the CGI. This movie was made for $80 million. Mm. I don't understand how. The dynamics of what's already been established in the Alien universe, like the acid blood, the facehuggers, all that sort of stuff is used so, so well. Like I said, the production design, the sci-fi just world building is just incredible. There's characters you actually care about. We've a synthetic played by David Janssen. He plays Andy. He's like the brother of the main character Rain, who's played by Kaylee Spaney, and he's a synthetic, which is like an android-esque character. And the relationship between them is probably one of the stronger emotional stories that's been told in any of the Alien movies. So you really feel the stakes throughout. Practical sets, cinematic modernization of the established story. It's a really fun time. I don't think it's better than Alien in some ways. I think it takes a lot of it's a lot of nostalgia, a lot of callbacky, similar to a bit like The Force Awakens and Jurassic World, but I didn't mind it.
Okay. The reason this works, and I think the reason that the first two Alien movies works and why some of the other ones don't, I think it's a trend that we're starting to see. You haven't seen 3
and 4, no.
Or 4.
Yeah.
Have you seen the Alien versus Predator movies?
No.
Okay. Well, the reason the first two Aliens movies were, and the reason I think this one works compared to, say, definitely Prometheus and definitely Alien Covenant, is that the characters we're following are just down-to-earth people.
Yeah.
And they're just, like, scrambling just, like, to, like, in this case, just get off the planet. Whereas, like, say, in the first Alien movie, like, it's literally just space truckers who happen to come upon a thing. Whereas you look at Prometheus and you look at Alien Covenant, the characters in that are, like, supposed to be these super geniuses. They're supposed to be, like, scientists and military men and have all the best tech and stuff. And they just make all these stupid fucking decisions. Like, especially in Alien Covenant. Like, the worst thing about that and the biggest criticism that people seem to have about that movie is that, like, they just... You've these smart people that just make incredibly stupid decisions. Whereas in this, it's like, as you say, this young kind of group of people, and they're just doing anything they can to get off this, like, hellhole of a planet. Like, it says at the start that this planet has no sunlight, like, all year round, no sunlight, and they just have to work these hours to try and get off, and the corporation just is doing everything it can to like keep these people here. So, like, you understand their motivations and what they're doing, they're doing what they're doing, but then also the decision making when they get into the situation with the aliens. I don't think anyone makes a decision that, like, isn't calculated or doesn't make sense in what they do, like, or what that character should do, like,
or if someone's trying to make that decision, someone's like, what the fuck are you
doing? Exactly. And there's questions to it, so that's another reason. And then I think the main point of this movie is it gets back to that roots of it being a horror movie, because that's what Alien always was. I know Cameron turned it into more of an action movie, but even then it was a horror movie. Like, it was these, like, space troops who thought they were the shit, and then they get into this situation where they're totally overwhelmed, they don't know what to do. As you say, I think, like, the production's great in the fact that you can see they built a number of sets, and it's all kind of filmed, like, in one of a number of locations, but they reuse them in a way that it makes sense that, like, they have to go through a certain hallway a number of times because, you know, they're going from one location to another. And it's not lazy. in the sense that, like, you might say from other movies that they're just doing the same thing. And then action set pieces that they do, again, it's, they had one of a number of different set pieces kind of lined up, and the links between them, they're not like incredible, but it's like, it makes sense that you're going from one to the other. Whereas you see with, say, definitely at the end of Covenant, like, it was all leading up to fighting the xenomorph on the ship.
The neomorph.
Or the neomorph, whatever. Yeah, it is. But like, getting to that point was just like so weird. It's just like, we'll just get the alien on board and we'll figure it out from there. So I had a great time with this. Yeah, as I say. And it, again, kind of just gets back to that roots of the Weyland-Yutani Corporation just being like terrible people and just like down to earth, kind of normal people, not like, don't have all the tech in the world. They're supposed to be just kind of these, as you know, as the first movie is, they're just space truckers, or, you know, in this case, it's space miners and stuff. And they're just looking for a better life, just get out of that hellhole and stuff. You mentioned, I think Kaylee Spaney does a decent job. I don't think she's out of this world. I think Davy Johnson is probably the star of the show because he has to really spread himself across a number of different emotions, we'll say.
Yeah.
And then, the aliens never look better. I really like the look of the aliens in this.
They're just so gross. I think that's what they're just so gross, man.
And there's also a number of unique looks.
Yeah. The one with the vagina on the wall.
Yeah.
There's something. Yeah, if you watch the movie, you'll know exactly what I'm talking
and
about.
And there's a number of like, it's not a spoiler to say there's a lot of people that are killed in this movie, but there's a number of kills that are like different to what you've seen previously, which is great.
There's definitely a point in which the movie takes a turn towards the end that people could either be very on board or very against. I was so wrapped up in it, I didn't care. I was like, fuck yeah.
And like, what I'd like to say is that Fede Alvarez, he's obviously used the best bits of, say, Alien and Aliens, but he's also tried to link in Prometheus as best he could. As weird and as kind of off the wall those movies are, especially Prometheus. It's a
completely different focus.
Yeah, well, I don't really know what Ridley Scott was trying to do with those, but like, he's trying to incorporate it as best he can. But yeah, just, and like, I can understand some people saying like the whole kind of legacy sequel criticism, but personally, like, I like The Force Awakens.
This is what I mean in the sense of like, you cannot, I'm not saying it's bad, but you can question its originality and its creativity. Because you're just kind of taking the best bits.
Yeah.
Similar to what I might have said about Blink Twice. And there are some very overt callbacks to a lot of things, like someone repeats the line of like, get your hands off or you bitch or something. Is that the line? So like, there's stuff like that which I could see people rolling their eyes with, but I was kind of too much wrapped up in the enjoyment of it all to kind of care. And I just went in for the ride, and it was just like a really good alien movie. Yeah. And we haven't got those in 40 years. So I think
also, the other thing is there's a number of ticking clock elements to this, which just add, again, that extra bit of intensity and tension.
It's, everything is so well weaved together because you know where they are in the ship, you know where they have to get to, there's a element where the gravity keeps turning on and off, and that, how that affects different set pieces and different actions they have to take. So all that is used very well.
There's nothing that they incorporate, say, later on in the movie that wasn't already called upon earlier and stuff.
Yes.
So there's nothing like that comes out of off the wall or anything like that. The last thing I was just going to mention is, and it's one thing that a lot of big, I wouldn't say blockbuster, I don't know if this is blockbuster. Sorry, that was the other thing. We didn't see this opening weekend.
No.
We saw this on a Wednesday, the week after, and it was packed out.
Jars!
Yeah, and it was weird, because like, a Wednesday is a weird time to go to the cinema. But anyway, very good crowd. The last thing I'll mention, and it's
very good crowd.
Yeah.
Well behaved.
The last thing I'll mention, and I think it's a lost art of big blockbusters, whatever, I don't know if you call this a big blockbuster.
This made no money.
Franchise movies, is the art of a poster.
Yes.
Incredible.
David's showing me the poster. Yeah. It's effective.
It's just beautiful. And it just incorporates everything you know about the Alien franchise in that. I just thought that was brilliant. And again, it's something that really pops.
Yeah.
Because I always think like, it needs to be something that pops when you're walking through like the corridors, in Omniplex in our case, that like, oh wow, look at that, I want to see that. So yeah, just a lost art that we're kind of, I'd like to see it in this.
Rather than a floating head poster.
Yeah, fuck me.
The last thing I wanted to mention to you, the last thing you wanted to mention is, I forgot there is a character recreated with CGI in this. Janky as fuck. I was fine with it. Didn't bother me, but a lot of people are quite upset with it.
So I think what they could have probably done is made him more
disfigured. Yes.
That could have helped.
But so I don't want to say too much about it, but I could see why people are upset about it. But just know all the parties that had to agree to it, agreed to it.
Yeah.
The CGI is not fantastic, but it is a fun way it's a fun element in this movie that connects it with the other Alien movies. Absolutely, that I quite enjoyed because I don't want to say too much about it, but I enjoyed it. So if anyone else has a problem with it, tell you what, you fucking take it up with David. He'll fight you. Thanks, David.
Yeah, I'm the muscle of this podcast.
Yeah. I'm the brains, you're the brawn. Actually, no, you're the brains. I don't know what I bring. I just edit these. I'm all talk. Right, shall we start talk about the movies coming out next month?
Oh, can you wait?
Mate.
September.
This is a weird month, all right?
September is typically a weird month, isn't it?
So first things, we've got Beetlejuice. Yeah. It's getting very good reviews. I was shitting on this quite a lot. I didn't like the look of the trailer. I felt like it was too long since the last one. Tim Burton came out and said he didn't watch the original in preparation for this.
Beetlejuice is very of its time.
Yes.
It's one of those cult classics of the 80s.
And especially a Tim Burton cult classic where those were weird. And I was just like, my worries about this was, I saw the makeup and I saw him in the trailer, Michael Keaton, and he just looked like it was an SNL skit.
Yeah.
And the problem was, Tim Burton's movie quality has only been going down.
Yeah.
And I just felt like Michael Keaton now, come back to Batman, come back to Beetlejuice, he's like, how can I get a load of cash before I retire?
Yeah.
But by all accounts, it's quite good. I think casting Jenna Ortega was fantastic because she's perfectly of the Tim Burton-y type.
Yeah.
Catherine O'Hara's back. I was wondering why the husband didn't come back, and then I read his Wikipedia and it's a good thing he's not back. Would have liked seeing Gina Davis back, but Alec Baldwin made me not because I read his Wikipedia. He's weird as well. But yeah, I hope it's fun. I'm looking forward to it. But Michael Keaton's having the time of his life.
Yeah.
Doing the press for it. He's come out and said that he's in it. I think he's only in for 17 minutes. Yeah. So,
but he is a side character. Like yes. He is, so it makes sense.
Yeah. It's all about a family tragedy, blah blah blah, they're all back again doing stuff.
If you've seen the first
one. There's a movie called Speak No Evil coming out the next weekend.
Interesting.
It's got James McAvoy in it, where an American family is invited to spend the weekend at an idyllic country estate of a charming British family. They befriended on vacation. What begins as a dream holiday soon warps into a snarled psychological nightmare. That's what you get for making friends with the Brits.
I saw a poster of this and it was said it was from the same producers as something else. I can't remember what it was. Maybe it was Ready or Not, but that doesn't make sense. It was Blumhouse, but I can't remember what it was. Anyway,
it's directed by a guy called Christian Tafdumpf, who did Speak No Evil, which is this movie. Who is producing it here now? It's written by Chris Tafdumpf, who directed Speak No Evil, which is this movie. By a guy called Jacob Jarek and just a guy called Trent. Now, Jacob Tarek has directed Speak No Evil, which is this movie. And Trent has... Oh, he produced a movie called Speak No Evil, which is this movie, and nothing else I've noticed. So that was a fun 5 minutes to just waste on talking about Speak No Evil. But it's got... You know what, David? I'm a fool. That's the one from the last... That's a different Speak No Evil.
There's a different Speak No Evil.
I'm an idiot. That was one from 2022. But it's actually... I think it's actually... the one this is based on, because that's a Danish family. But this is directed by a guy called James Watkins, David, and he's directed a movie called Bastille Day and another one called The Woman in Black. And he also directed the Black Mirror episode of Shut Up and Dance.
There you go.
And it's written by James Watkins. He's done weird stuff. Yeah, I'm not really seeing anything.
Nah, never mind.
So it's Jason Blum who's done all the Whiplash, Get Out, Us, Split. Everything you can think of. Then there's nothing the following weekend.
Wow. Everyone's getting out of the way of Beetlejuice, isn't it?
No. And then there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 movies coming out that one weekend. So one is called Apartment 7A, which is a prequel to Rosemary's Baby.
That looks so sketch.
I don't know how I feel about it. Then there's a movie. Oh, yes. There's actually a movie technically coming out on the 20th.
The Invisible Man. It was the same producers as The Invisible Man, was also a good movie. So this could be a good movie.
Who knows? We'll go see this on a Monday, Spooky Mondays.
Yeah,
Wolves is out on the 27th, but it's actually
Wolves.
It's meant to be out on the 20th for 1 week of release, so it can be nominated for stuff.
And then who are they playing that
Apple.
Week?
It's called, it's being released on Apple TV Plus on the 27th. It's got Brad Pitt. Brad Pitt, George Clooney getting paid way too much money. It's got Mark Webb, who did all the Spider-Man movies as well.
Okay. Cool.
It looks like a fun title. It looks like a fun buddy cop movie that'll be average, and they've made so much money from it. Yeah. So I'm glad they're having a fun time. Then there's a new Hellboy movie coming out.
Wow.
Yeah, it's called Hellboy: The Crooked Man.
Did you see the other one?
David Harbour? No.
Yeah.
But there's a new one. Then we've got a movie called The Outrun, which is Saoirse Ronan's in it.
Yeah.
It looks like a fun time.
Does it actually look like a fun time? Or nope. Does it?
Well, it's all about Rona, fresh out of rehab, returns to the Orkney Islands.
That sounds
a place
so
both
much fun.
Wild and beautiful right off the Scottish coast. After more than a decade living life on the edge in London, where she found both love, where she both found and lost love, Rona, now 30, attempts to come to terms with her troubled past as she reconnects with the dramatic landscape where she grew up. Memories of her traumatic childhood merge with the more recent challenging events that have set her on her path to recovery.
Hilarious.
Oh man, it's a fun romp. It's based in Scotland, man. We've also got another movie called Never Let Go. It's a horror movie. Halle Berry's in it, but what I think is going to be the talk of the town, Megalopolis.
Yeah, this could be...
It's directed by...
This could be incredible.
What's his face? Francis Ford Coppola.
Yeah, he's gone insane. He's sunk all his money into this.
He's cast a cast of...
He's
cast a cast of... actors that he described as cancelled, that he wanted to give another chance. So John Voight's in it, Shia LaBeouf's in it, some other sketchy people are in it.
Interesting.
I think so. I don't know. I'll double check that before I make some ludicrous claims.
Adam Driver, of course.
What's Adam Driver do? Like, who... Like, why does he keep picking the weirdest, worst
movies? I think what happened was he went for the Oscar buzz and then no one gave him any recognition, so he's like, fuck it. I'm going to get paid.
Yeah, you got Lawrence Fishburne, Catherine Hunter, Dustin Hoffman.
Where's Fishburne didn't do anything?
No, but he said he wanted to cast more cancelled people or something about cancelled people. Adam Driver, Giancarlo Esposito. But yeah, wait until you hear this. Okay. Rena, fresh out of rehab. You got...
that was Rona.
Sorry. Genius artist Caesar Catalina seeks to leap the city of New Rome into a utopian idealistic future where his opposition, Mayor Franklin Cicero, remains committed to a regressive status quo, perpetrating greed, special interests, and partisan warfare. Torn between them is a socialite, Julius Cicero. I assume I'm saying that right. C-I-C-E-R-O? Cicero?
Sure, sounds right.
The mayor's daughter, whose love for Caesar has divided her loyalties, forcing her to discover what she truly believes humanity deserves. It's like a weird parable, metaphor, weird thing.
Is there another Megalopolis?
You're thinking of like the one from 1910, isn't it? Metropolis?
Okay. Yeah, is there any link to that? No?
I don't know.
Okay.
Yeah, this looks so weird. It's meant to be getting utterly panned at all the film festivals. And then they released the trailer. Did you hear about this?
No.
They released the trailer with reviews of his other movies like The Godfather, Apocalypse Now, that also got bad reviews, Dracula. Yeah. But they had to take the trailer down because those reviews weren't true.
They were from other movies. Of those movies did get poorly reviews.
They did, but they used
the wrong ones.
They used the wrong ones. They said like, suspiciously, predominantly famous reviewers. They used their reviews for other movies. Like one of the movies, I could be wrong here, but something like Batman Returns, they used a phrase from that reviewer's review of that movie and used it for, let's say, Apocalypse Now.
All right, sorry.
Yeah.
I was like, he didn't direct Batman Returns.
No, but that was, it was just, this looks awful.
I will say, I listened to the Weekly Planet Boys and they had a guy on who did see it. He seemed to enjoy it. Now, again, that's just one guy's opinion, but I'm interested to see it. There is a bit in it. Have you been contacted by Omniplex to do the bit where you have to talk to the screen? Have you heard about this?
What?
There's a bit in the movie where Adam Driver talks to someone in the theater.
Yeah.
And you have to respond. Someone has to respond. So some kid who was on like minimum wage and Omniplex has to like get up and...
That's gross.
Yeah.
I fucking hate this movie.
Yeah.
I really am not looking forward to this. I will watch it, absolutely, for content. But I'm not happy about it. It looks... It's just someone who... It's someone who has far too much time and resources to just put out into the world an absolutely unfiltered and unmonitored version of what he thinks to be true, and like people should enjoy it and listen to it.
Yeah.
I mean, watch it. Whoops.
Exactly.
There's a Freudian slip. Zach from Antidona went to go see it over in Australia, and his review was, to be fair, if I had $120 million and no notes, I'd probably try to make something like this.
I'm interested. I think this could be crazy.
Sure. I don't know, man. I think it's going to be really wanky.
Yeah.
Okay. Fine.
Sure.
You into that?
I mean, like, look, I'll go see it.
Fine. Sure, there's nothing else out in September except for every movie in the world. It's coming out September
27th.
Yeah. Right, which one are you looking forward to most? Megalopolis or Beetlejuice?
I'm not really too buzzed about Beetlejuice. Again, it could be fine.
Like, yeah.
How long is it? If it's over an hour and 50.
Hour 44.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Hey, now, I want to have you up.
That's probably an hour and 40 with credits.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Stacked cast. Winona Ryder, Jenna Ortega, Monica Bellucci, Willem Dafoe.
When was the last time Tim Burton made a good movie? Don't say Wednesday. That doesn't count.
All right. Tim Burton. It's the point of the podcast where we just start Googling stuff. Tim Burton.
I think we had this conversation before as well.
Was it in real life or?
No, yeah.
Was it on the podcast?
No.
Do you count Dumbo?
I haven't seen it, but you said it was great.
Haunting. Miss Peregrine's
doesn't
Home
count.
For
That doesn't count.
Why not? He directed it.
Yeah, I know. It's still shite.
Okay. Big Eyes.
Don't know what that is.
Frankenweenie.
Didn't see it.
Dark Shadows.
Maybe I just haven't seen his movie. You know what? Dark Shadows. Yeah, I'm sure that's great.
Alice in Wonderland.
It's fine. It's, yeah.
Sweeney Todd, the demon barber of Fleet Street.
Could be good.
Again, Corpse Bride.
Maybe I just don't watch his movies.
Charlie and the Chocolate Factory.
Yes, that was my favorite.
Hello, that's my... Starshine. The Earth says hello. Haunting. Big Fish.
Planet of the Apes. I would say Big Fish is objectively good. So yeah, we'll go with that.
Planet of the Apes.
No.
Sleepy Hollow.
No.
Mars Attacks.
No.
Ed Wood. You should watch Ed Wood.
Yeah. Okay. So
Batman Returns. Joe, I'm starting to think he's not a good director.
Exactly. Who keeps giving them this money?
I don't fucking know, man. Anyway.
Wait, where could we get this Hollywood money?
Yeah. I want to make Megalopolis.
Yeah.
I want to cast a load of cancelled people in it. Jesus. Anyway. Right.
I was trying to think of an Irish person. Who's Irish and cancelled?
Bertie Ahern.
Yeah, he's fucking cancelled.
Right, David. Anything else?
No, I'm good. Go see Alien.
And Blink Twice.
Romulus and Blink Twice.
Yeah.
Those movies deserve
And Kneecap a bit.
And Kneecap.
So Kneecap is my third favourite movie of the year and Alien Romulus is my second.
Blink Twice is first.
Not on the list. I haven't decided yet. I'll see. Does it beat King Kong versus Godzilla, the new empire? I had a really fun time with it, David. The one of the big monkeys uses the little monkey to hit the other monkeys. It's a lot of fun. Anyway. And then I still have Sweaty Tennis Match as my number one movie of the year. So
really?
Far. Yeah, I love it. Right, David. As always, number 42, Meaning of Life. Thanks, Mil.
I think I've got it.
You've got it now? Yeah. You feel happy?
Yeah. I think I've...
Yeah, Meaning of Life is... I need to find a better way to spend my life.
Yeah, exactly.
Thanks to people who listen to this. If you want to keep up to the podcast, Instagram, at Reading It Appears, TikTok, YouTube, Letterboxd. First 5 people get a prize.
Tell us what you saw.
Tell us what you saw the other day. Give us an email at readingitappears@gmail.com if you want as well. Subscribe. Give us 5 stars or else. And make sure to watch Mrs. Doubtfire.
My life is on the line, people. You need to give us 5 stars.
Or else...